Hello and welcome to Mission TV Live. It's such a blessing to see you today, and I'm so glad that we're here, but I'm having a problem.
What's that?
Look at the TV. Anyway,
we're on the TV.
We have John with us today, we have Thad, and we have Marty Phillips with us today, and it's such a blessing to have Thad back. Your cough is better, so we're thankful for that. And Marty, it's been a while since we've been able to have you on a live, but it's a blessing to have you here, and we look forward to what you have to share with us. And I think we have a video we want to share at the beginning here.
In a little bit, I just kind of want to set up, Marty was one of the first people that we interviewed.
That's right.
Back in
5 years or something.
Yeah.
Almost 6 years ago,
yes. Almost 6 years ago.
Yeah, so really glad to have you back.
Well, thank you.
Enjoyed that. The set was a little different back
then. It was.
We were planning on building this big set and had all kinds of details, and it was going to be beautiful, and we're like, we didn't have the money or the time, so we just bought some lawn furniture.
Yeah.
The deck furniture, porch furniture, and set it up there with the black background on the walls, and you were one of the first ones there. And
I don't remember anything about the furniture, but I remember the black background.
Yeah.
I thought it was very ingenious.
Yeah.
And but you, God blessed.
Yeah.
Really.
And at that time, 2010, you were just transitioning.
I was. And a lot has happened over the last 5-6 years since we originally spoke.
Yeah. You were before that, you were working in where were you working at that
time?
Well,
at that time, I had just moved here and I had started our organization. Prior to that, I had worked for the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, as well as for their department and or organizational unit in the Middle East and North Africa region. Mm-hmm. And I had, for various reasons, moved back to the U.S. Mm-hmm. and then continued somewhat in the same line of work I had been doing prior to that, working with underground house churches in high security areas.
High security area. I guess this is a good time to talk about how we're going to talk about where you work and what you do.
So we work today, now 6 years later, we work in around 25 or 26 different countries in the area commonly known as the 1040 window in mission circles. Basically, the area of most need, also the area where there has been the least amount of evangelism, which takes parts of North Africa, Middle East, and Asia.
Most need, least evangelism.
Yes.
Most need as in?
Just a lot of poor areas are in that part of the world, a lot of war, a lot of poverty, but also
unreached
there's
people groups.
Unreached people groups. There's, I don't remember, maybe the majority of the 5,000 or whatever, 5,600 unreached people groups. There's several ways to define people groups, but probably about 5,600 of them are in that 1040 window area.
So the majority of all unreached people groups are in that area.
Exactly.
Yeah, okay. So, but before you were working in that same area, but maybe not as broad, right?
Yeah, I worked at that time, I was a part of a team that worked with house churches, underground house churches in Muslim countries. Today, we not only work with Muslims, we work with Hindus. We're branching out to like traditional Chinese and also to very remote
Buddhist areas and animist areas
where there have been, let's say, unreached animist groups still.
Okay, so when we were talking to you, you were transitioning and starting.
Just starting at that time, I was involved with a bit of business formation. At that time, helping some of the ministries I'd work with get into businesses. And since
business formation.
Business formation.
Yeah, see, when we talk to Marty, he's going to be throwing out these terms that he just takes for granted.
But sorry.
Most people, no, it's fine. I mean, you can throw them out, but we might
we
say, hey, Marty,
can you define
what
some
is
of these?
Business permission. Most people, and I was just talking to somebody today, that you got, if you want to go after the world and the pleasures of the world, you go into business. And if you want to serve God, you go and be a pastor or something like that. But business formation, What's that?
Well, this is something that I would like to share a bit about today. And I'm glad you brought that up. It's kind of providential. Something I think that we've inherited from Mennonites who developed this, they've developed strongly two areas that most of the world haven't, is how do you deal with aggression or violence in a non-violent way without running away, without flight? They use the term without fight or without flight. How do you deal with evil? That's one thing that Mennonites have given to the rest of the Christian world, and this is why we as Seventh-day Adventists today traditionally have not been involved in war. We've only taken one little piece, and they have a whole theology built around how do you deal with a violent person or with war without fighting and without fleeing.
Okay, you... Business and mission.
That's separate.
War.
The area, I know I digress some, and another area that they have is that God has given business to develop his kingdom. And so if you're a business person.
Oh, sorry. Say that again. A little slower. God has given
business to develop God's kingdom. Either Satan uses it or God uses it.
You mean somebody goes into business, makes a lot of money, and sends them over the missions?
No. That's only a partial result. You use the influence you have through your employees, through your contacts, through your clients to build God's mission.
Okay, so that's crazy because I thought I was the only one. Because I spent a year in Thailand and I came to the conviction that a business owner in Thailand would have more influence as a Christian than a pastor would.
Absolutely.
By far.
Absolutely.
Because you're hiring local people, you work with them, you show them Christian character, you know, respect. It is such a contrast to what they normally see in an employer. And you can hire thousands, and they're with you all day long, you know, 40
it's
hours
true.
A week.
I actually, as you bring this up, and it's also a bit of a digression, but I know a Chinese businessman in Thailand, and he is a very large businessman. He is a major magnate in a certain industry, and he has tens of thousands of employees, and he has become convicted that God has given him that business for him to be able to share with his Buddhist employees that he has tens of thousands, literally. He's a major, he's into the rubber business, and he owns some of the largest plantations of rubber in the world, into the hundreds of thousands of acres, several all over Asia, from Vietnam. He owns massive amount, and so he sees that God has dropped this in his lap, first from inheritance, and then by just his business. He feels he has almost a supernatural gifting from God as long as he keeps his business oriented for God.
Wow.
And he just sees he has a massive opportunity. So interesting you brought Thailand, that you saw that. I know a Thai businessman from Chinese origin that was convicted, but God convicted me in my own little way. Now, you had asked me before something I wanted to share. And it's something I've been passionate about. I have found that there are keys to unlocking extraordinary mission, where we see explosive viral growth in mission.
What do you mean extraordinary?
Where we
viral
see... Where explosive. You see one person plant 50 house churches. 100, for example. I know someone, I have many people that work in my network who have planted over 100 house churches in less than five years.
Okay, so he just goes in there, preaches a series, baptizes a bunch of people.
This is the difference.
Puts a big number on the...
He plants it through his natural existing social networks. What do I mean by this? You're a business person and you have your social network. You're a tribal elder or a tribal chief. You take the gospel of God's kingdom through your tribe. You are a teacher, a tutor. For example, I have one of the people in our network. He's a tutor, and he teaches and prepares students to pass their examinations. And he has a lot of very wealthy families that hire him. And so what did he do? He felt convicted when he learned the gospel. He's a Hindu Brahmin. And all these wealthy Brahmin families, he felt connected, felt, God has given me this big network of very wealthy families for me to teach their children. Wow. I need to take the kingdom. So what did he do? He went around to 120 some families and he planted a house church in each one of those families.
Marty, this is incredible, and I knew this was going to happen, but we've got to take a little break because we have a special feature. And the special feature is this a video that we found, one of our student missionaries that's serving in India for the year from Southern, and he is in our orphanage. And we talk about an orphanage. We talk about poor children. Mission. We talk about people over there. We're going to be talking about them here today. But I want to show you this clip because it shows somebody that it's transitioned from a number or a statistic to something a little bit more. So this is DJ Somerville, and to set this up, he's been in an orphanage and one of the kids has basically rejected the care that we've been trying to provide, and he's wanting to leave.
Didn't want to abide by the rules.
Didn't want to abide by the rules, which were there for his, you know, his sake. But anyway, we're going to go ahead and play this video now.
Hey everyone, just me, the lonely Indian. Today was probably the hardest day I've had in India. It may be the hardest day I've had in my entire life. And it started off great. I got up this morning and we started working. We're making a volleyball court. And so what we do is we dig up some of the dirt. It's got tons of rocks in it. And then we sift through it. We got like a little filter thing. And we sift out all the big rocks. And we did that for 2 hours. And then we were getting kids ready to go to school, and one of my boys said he didn't want to go. And I was like, well, you need to go. You just had 10 days break. It's time to go to school. And I said, nope, I'm going home. So like, well, you're probably not going home. You're going to school. Please get dressed. Or you can, I mean, if you really want to have a sick day, sick days are no fun, you're shut in your room all day. And he's like, no, 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 I'm going to my village. So, we called his guardians, and he's leaving. And it really sucks, because I'm losing my child. You know, I'm his brother, but I'm also his father sometimes. And he's leaving. And it just hurts really bad because, you know, I pour out everything. You know, I love on him. I pray with him. And you just, you give all you have. And then he takes it and then he just doesn't want it anymore and he walks away. And I was thinking about how I do that to God almost on a daily basis. You know, he gives me stuff, pours out blessings on me, gives me clothes, food, friends, just life. And I take that, I take his endless love. I just take it and take and take and take. And then at some point I say, all right, thanks for all the free stuff. Deuces, and I turn and walk away. And that's just, that's so not fair. And I never really understood, like, people say that, you know, we break God's heart when we turn our backs on him. And I was like, okay, yeah, but how bad does that really hurt? But Now I've experienced the feeling of losing one of your children. Losing your boy. You just give and give, and he says thank you. And as he's leaving, he gives you a hug and says, I'm sorry. I'm gonna miss you. But then he walks away anyway. And I'm standing there just saying, why? I don't understand. Why? But there's nothing I can do. He's chosen that. And we do that so often to God. We choose our own path and we say, thanks God, I love you, I'll miss you. But we walk out anyway. It just doesn't make sense. He's sitting there saying, why? All I've done is give. I gave my son. I give you life. I give you air to breathe. I give you everything. I just love on you. Why are you leaving? I don't have an answer. I don't understand it. But, I don't know. Just keep that in mind. Next time you're going to do something stupid, just think about, you know, how you're walking out on God after everything he's given you. And I wouldn't wish this feeling on anybody ever again, because it's awful. But I kind of wish that everyone could feel it just for a minute. So you'd understand, you know, just a minute, you know, how awful it is. Just to watch one of your boys, one of your children, just walk out of your life. You can't stop. That's just my thoughts. From on top of our water tank in the middle of India. Hope you guys are having a better day than me. Catch you later.
All right.
So that is a little picture into the heart of God, and that is why we're doing this, and this is why God is calling us into his work, calling you to get involved with his work, because when we start connecting with people outside, other parts of the world, other people other than us, we start to get a glimpse, little glimpse of the heart of God, how much he cares. And so how often have you seen a young man cry like that? To me, this is so poignant, that you transition from a statistic, you know, an orphan in India, to this is
like my son.
Yeah, you get a name on this. You get a name with the statistic, with the number. And it's no longer a number. It's a person. It's somebody that you know. And that's why we take mission trips. We take vision trips. We can go over there. Like the first time we went, it took you in 98. You know, we went as tourists. Mm-hmm. We went to the orphans there in Burma. And they became friends. So it wasn't the missionaries across the seas, it was Pastor Balatane, it was Magnolia, it was these kids that we know. And I know that that's what drives you. When you talk about these things, you don't see numbers. And you talk about these people that are reached and that don't know the gospel. It's more than just a number for you, don't you think?
Absolutely. I know many of the people by... We probably have about 30,000 house churches altogether. Mm-hmm. And I obviously don't know 30,000 house church leaders, but I know all the major movers and shakers in the movement. Mm-hmm. And I'm in a regular contact for them, and it's just been exciting to see. Some of them I have been working with for almost 15 years. Mm-hmm. And I started with one group with one house church. Mm. And now there are more than 12,000 house churches in a very closed country in the Middle East, in a country where you would go to jail. Even if you're caught with a Bible, you could be beaten, you could lose your life. And into that country, in the most amazing way, we have been able to put over about 100,000 Bibles. And we find that almost every Bible that we distribute turns into a family of believers who then host a house church in their home.
Wow.
And it's much like a house church from a New Testament model, where the house church is based around the Greek under the Middle Eastern understanding of an oikos. That's the home. And that's made up of the family, your brothers, your sisters, their families.
Okay. Anoikos.
Anoikos.
I don't know what that means.
This is a Greek word for home or for house, but it means your household.
Okay.
So it's your household, but it's bigger than our American concept of household.
But it's not ecclesia.
It's not ecclesia. Okay. Ecclesia is something else, and we can share a lot about that, but maybe at a different time. But oikos, the house, the ecclesia was built around the oikos, which is your immediate household. That's you, your family, your extended family, your parents, your siblings, their families.
Nuclear family, nuclear church.
Is your church. And so this is how we have found one of the, instead of pulling people from all over town, you and your extended family have a family church. So it might be 8, 10, 15 people, what your family is, and then God gives spiritual gifts within that family. The husband leads, many times the wife leads the family into worship, the kids all participate, you plan how can we build God's kingdom beyond our family. So our neighbors, why don't we invite them once they're excited? Then our neighbors will learn from our family how to live a godly life. What does it mean to live where the husband and wife love each other, where you discipline your kids without anger, and you come together once a week or twice a week to worship together, and they learn, you have modeled for them, and now they go plant, and then you bring the neighbor next door, and they bring their cousins who live down across town, and this is how we have just seen it go viral, through your existing social networks.
Okay, so viral and explosive.
Yes.
Because there is a resistance in many of these countries to the gospel.
There's resistance to Christendom.
Well, that's the gospel, right?
No. There's resistance to a 16th century or a 1960 looking church. There isn't usually resistance to Jesus. But there is resistance to
an organizational
form. You go in, it looks different. This doesn't look Muslim. This doesn't look Hindu. This doesn't look Buddhist.
It'd be like us going
into
Buddhist.
It looks Western.
It looks Western. And there's a lot of baggage that comes from British Empire times.
Such as, I thought things went well.
Not from the other side of the coin. There's maybe the masses, some of the poorer people in the countries, like the British, those people who had been in power in the past, who had been influential, usually suffered under British rule. Mm-hmm. And felt that America's always sided on that side, and then we took on an imperial role, financial imperial role. So there's a lot of baggage that comes from the West. And then today they see Christianity through the eyes of Hollywood. America's a Christian country, so how can a Christian country be producing things? It becomes synonymous with this. So you see modern America, modern West, the selfie culture, which they react against, and they react against imperial politics.
So these are people that are quite religious, spiritual, and maybe conservative
in
their value system.
We actually see, that's a good question, John. We see more growth. I like to see, our movement grows among people who are already mostly religious, deeply devout religious people.
Because you know some Hindus, Buddhists, Muslims that are more devout than the majority of Christians.
And we see the gospel advance much faster among the more devout than in secular. Many times they say, let's get these secular people in Muslims or in Hindus or Buddhist. They tend to be secular Christians many times. They'll have their first love, but it's a part of being a part of the modern world many times. And I used to work in the Middle East, and I worked for Adventist. I had part of my portfolio was with AWR, Adventist World Radio.
Part of your portfolio?
It was part of my portfolio of my job descriptions. I worked for the union at one time there, and I had many portfolios. One of it was follow-up for...
You're not just a standard pastor type, are you? Pastors don't talk about their portfolios. They talk about their church. You sound like a businessman, like, you know, or some
investor.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know that. Well, I had many job functions. Okay. And that's how we called it. So.
All right, it's your portfolio. So, like,
well, that's
focuses.
Okay, because we're supposed to invest, right? Invest in the souls. So,
well, I just had numerous responsibilities, and one of my responsibilities was follow-up for AWR. And we found out that 75% in the Middle East of our follow-up was 18 to 22-year-olds. And 90% of those after the sixth letter was, how can you help me get to America? And these are peripheral people that they want to become Christians. They want to leave their religion. They don't like where they are. They want to be a part of the West.
A little bit of money incentive, financial.
There could be financial incentive, these types of things, and so.
But it's not the heart of the, of that people group.
It's not the heart. So, if I have found, as I shared here a few weeks ago on a non-life program, what we have found key to really sparking powerful movements for Christ, a person has to be tied to their people. Tied to their land, and so that's this meaning that no matter what happens, they're not going to leave. Whether they're a believer or not, they will never leave their country, they will never leave their people group. They're extremely tied to both, and they're a person of influence already. And so these type of person, and that God has been working in them and their family for centuries. You will find that God weaves histories to where we are today.
Okay, you're going into a non-Christian people group.
Yes.
Into what many would be consider heathen people groups.
Yes.
And yeah, I know you're struggling with that term, but anyway, going into heathen people group, and you're saying you look for people that God has been working with their family for centuries?
Exactly. What, you know, many times we, and I think it's really sad, we have focused on where God is. And if we want to see viral growth, focus where God has been working. God has worked in the ancient past, He has worked in the near past, He's working today, and He hasn't left anyone without some showing of His revelation to
them. What do you mean by anyone? He hasn't left anyone.
He hasn't left any people group.
In the world?
In the world.
So any people group in the world,
you will find, I have gone to the darkest. I've read about this, then I wanted to challenge, is it true? I've gone to the innermost hinterlands of, like, Sudan, South Sudan and Africa, where you have 750 tribes. Not one of those tribes have been left without some revelation of God's Spirit.
Serious.
Absolutely. You know, if we go to Acts 17, it says God gave every people a time and a place so that they might reach out and find Him. God also then, I guess, I can't remember, in Jeremiah, He says God's eyes are like a rowboat going to and fro, like a row oars, going to and fro throughout all the world looking for those who will trust Him. It doesn't say Jewish people, it doesn't say Christian people. He's looking for all people.
Wow. So God is working.
Yes.
In the deepest heathen.
Absolutely.
Place. God is there.
He is there. Satan is there and God is there. But God hasn't left them without a revelation, at least a partial dim revelation of Himself.
Are you saying that all religions are equal? And
I am not. This is why you need mission.
Okay.
But there are diamonds and gems of truth that, instead of ignoring them, many times we would go as the missionary and we would dump everything out and not look to where God had been working. And I will give you an example.
Wow. Thad had a comment.
Well, I was just going to say that I've read some books that paneled a lot of people groups all over the world, and when you dig into their legends of where they come from, there's echoes of the Bible all through it. Creation, the flood, all this kind of stuff. It's all there in their mythology. It's been kind of twisted over the years, but it's all there. And so many of them, there's commonalities all through how they and you can find those similarities.
The seeds.
And the
seeds of God.
China, for instance, used to be monotheistic way back in its ancient past. They worshiped Sheng Da, who was a just God. He banned idol worship and all this kind of stuff. But it's been lost over the years. But as we dig into the histories of most of these people groups, we find that all roads lead back to Babel, essentially, but all roads lead back to God, and they all have echoes of His touch in their cultures throughout their whole history.
Well, I believe that God was in their past, but is God still currently working?
Well, see, this is what I think. There is what I have understood that, you know, we as Adventists have this understanding of the cosmic conflict,
right,
of what we commonly know as the Great Controversy. Mm-hmm. And we trace it, which was important for us. Mm. I come from a European background, like everyone in this group. Mm-hmm. And so the Great Controversy, as we know it, traces the struggle between God and Satan over our people groups. Mm. We're an amalgamation of Western European people groups. Mm-hmm. And we have seen how God and Satan fought over our people.
Right, down through the Dark Ages.
Exactly.
And the Reformation. And
something that became clear to me in my mission experience is, mm-hmm, there has been the same types of struggles over different issues in every people group.
Really?
And so then what I try to find...
So each people group could write a book called The Great Controversy.
Exactly. And this is what we try to do. Before we ever start a big mission program in that people group, we discover and we spend several years. There's work to be done. We try to understand that great controversy struggle.
You spend several years getting to know the people and the culture before you start?
Absolutely.
Makes sense.
But then it goes viral very fast.
You can explain to them the perspective from their own history and their own culture.
So you've had to go through the process of pulling the culture away from the gospel and putting the gospel seed into their terms.
Yes.
Into their culture. So it goes from the inside. So you're planting the seed inside the soil.
To learn, where has God and Satan been working in your culture? What footprints of God can you find? What cobwebs of Satan? So we find God's footprints that have been laid over the centuries, way back to talking the time of Babel. Many of them have these things. There was one true creator God. We know this and this, where we're supposed to do. Like in Sudan, they have two types of sacrifice. Every single tribe, they know if they sacrifice to the creator God of the universe, who were in animistic tribes, or they know if they're sacrificing to evil spirits. Without a question. I have interviewed so many tribes in South Sudan, there's no question that they knew before a Christian missionary ever came, they knew if they were sacrificing to the God of heaven or if they were sacrificing out of fear to the spirits.
Wow.
So then you find those footprints of God. You build on what they already knew of God. Most people know what belonged to heaven and what belonged to the evil one.
Wow. So most people know the difference between good and evil.
They do. They know. In their hearts of hearts, they know.
This rings true because Suti Nason is a guy that I interviewed. It's the India Face-to-Face show number 3. And he learned about Jesus from his black magic guru. He said, you know, we're praying to these demons and they're hurting the people. And how can we do good for them? He says, the black magic guru, teacher, big,
yes,
you know, and they were actually doing stuff, supernatural stuff. So they had tapped into the dark forces that were actually physically affecting the world and peoples. He says, in order to do good stuff, you have to pray to Jesus. This is coming from the Hindu black magic guru.
What I see, there's rules of engagement. That's another whole. God has laid down rules of engagement for mission, and Satan has to abide. If Satan is asked by a people that he's holding, where are we going to get peace? the answer has to be correct. He can't lie about that.
Really?
I don't think so. I think that God, there's only certain limits that he can give, but there are limits that God puts to Satan to how far he can go.
Okay, so you go in and you find these people that are tied to their land, committed to their country, committed to their people group, people of influence, people that are in the center of their people group, not periphery, not trying to get out.
Yes.
And find where God has been working, that they're aware that there's God and that there's Satan. And then what do you do then?
Then, you know, there's something amazing. God does something that brings you together and you both know you are followers of God. And they recognize you and you recognize them. You just see it. I will tell you a story of people from a certain close country. Uh-huh. We had never seen each other, but we agreed to meet in a third country for our mutual safety. Uh-huh. And they got off the airplane and they were coming out the airport and our eyes met and we instantly knew who each other was.
Really?
And, you know, there's these God moments. It's something that here in the West, most people would kind of, oh, what's this? But you just feel these are godly people. You can see it in there. Even though we have different people groups, different religions, they're people who have been living to the light that they had had.
So when you meet, even though you come from vastly different backgrounds, you guys get along like brothers.
Exactly. You're brothers in God. And then they're open. They feel a receptive. See, there's something that non-Western people, they feel the presence of good and evil. And if you're really going to be a witness to God, you must have they must feel the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life. Wow. And they can somehow tangibly feel something I can't. Mm. I can't feel tangible things, but I know Muslims, Hindus, and Buddhists, most of them, they can feel tangible the Spirit of God or the spirit of evil presence.
Wow.
And there's only usually one or the other at the same time.
Wow. Okay, so you find these people, you connect with them, and then what happens?
And then as they learn the gospel story, see what happens is Jesus comes and he shows us how to live in community in a way that we didn't understand before Christ. Mm. And in Christ, it's, you know, we see the Beatitudes. He shows us how to live a different life. Mm. And he calls us to a higher ground.
Okay, so these people know God, the Spirit, they don't know Jesus' story.
They don't know Jesus' story. And so as they get to know Jesus, they fall in love with Jesus. Mm. And Jesus is the way to the Father. Mm. We see the true character of God through Jesus. Mm. Wow, Jesus was willing not to shame Judas, but yet still called Judas, even in the Last Supper, knowing who Judas was. Mm. He doesn't shame Judas. And you know, in these types of things, you see, how do you become a peacemaker? Mm. How do you bring God's kingdom into our community? And this, people want to see tangible ways of how to do this.
Mm. How to deal with real struggles in their everyday life.
In their everyday life.
Their families.
And how Jesus answers. They give their lives to Jesus. They make them Lord of their lives. Uh-huh. And then they become a part of a brotherhood of believers.
And then Jesus starts working in their lives.
And then we've just seen powerful miracles in all three people groups that we work with. Uh-huh. Just very, or three or four people groups. I mean, big, like Muslim, Hindu, Buddhist.
Wow.
Just very powerful manifestations, like a New Testament.
And that confirms.
And this confirms that Jesus is real. It's not just a theory.
And then that's what just makes it.
And
like
it goes.
That.
And so now Jesus takes local dress because I, as a Westerner, is not seen. No one knows that I'm working with this more than maybe the first or second layer of leaders. Hmm. Hmm. And on it, like I know the national leader, but no one else knows who I am. I might visit them, but I'm a friend, a business person, something like this.
Right.
And they have no idea the spiritual connection I have with the group.
So then it looks like just something from the inside out has their own culture, their own people, their own familiarities. So there isn't anything that they have, there's no hurdle in order to hear this story.
Exactly. So we have taken the whole Western.
Yeah.
So if you want to see viral, explosive growth, the gospel has to be planted into that people group without an external visible presence. And so, for example, I have had very dear friends that have gone and worked for years and years in a close country, but they have been the center of trying to plant a house church. Mm. And I learned early on, I kept asking God, why did my dear friends, and I had several Adventists.
Who are these friends? I mean, they're
They were
Americans.
Missionaries, American missionaries, but they have gone to these closed countries, and they have tried to build a movement, but that movement has been around themselves. Mm. And so if you want to have a movement, you can only be a catalyst. So if, let's say, I move to wherever, let's say Nepal.
Okay.
Whatever. I come to Nepal. I don't try to plant a house church in my home. I start praying, Lord, send me to the person of peace, the person who is already respected in his community, who has tanned the light and land and people. Take me to the highest one possible in the nation, and I start praying
highest
for that.
Highest one, like in the mountains?
No, most no. The most influential. Excuse me. The person, the highest person under... who has the most influence in the nation or who can have
like
that influence.
Maybe.
If someone in his family, whatever, maybe his king. Anyone, the highest level, the faster it flows. Uh-huh. In this country, it would be probably the movie stars. So if I was trying to work in this country, I would try to go to Hollywood, plant a house church there, along closest to the houses of the most influential people, start praying, Lord, touch their lives. Help me build a relationship with them, help me build a circle of influence, and then let them change the nation.
Wow.
And so then, if coming back to the Nepal example, I would never try to start a house church myself. I would pray, lead me to a Buddhist monk family, or something like this, or to a Hindu family. You have both Hindus, Muslims, and Buddhists in Nepal. Lead me to one of these families, let me share it with him. I retract from him. People shouldn't even see our association too much. I mentor him in my family. Now you go plant this in your people group.
Wow.
So they don't see a Western face. You take all that baggage of what it means to be a part of an outside world. And then he grapples with what does it mean to be a believer. And he will call me, Marty, what do I do? I have this situation. How does a kingdom person live in this?
What do you do at a wedding?
What do you do at a funeral? What do you do? I had 18 months ago someone calling me. What do I do? Do I go to war or not?
Wow.
And so God has put me in people of influence. Do I go to war or not? I have 50 people in my home who are ready to declare war. We have just cause. We have been invaded. And I was sitting in church on Sabbath. I walk out and we pray and talk. He comes to a conclusion, I should not go to war.
Wow.
He now has to go face 50 people who have the power to declare war in his...
in his behalf, anyway.
On his behalf.
Wow.
And it wasn't a popular thing to go tell him not to go to war.
Yeah, I'm sure.
So you see everything from, you know, I'll take a more common thing. One of our... house church leaders, he comes, his father would be equivalent in his country. He's would be like a union president in the Adventist system. In his country, there's a big religious movement. And in that movement, his father is mid-management.
In which country? I'm sorry.
In a country.
Yeah, okay. Sorry. Just for the protection. It's a high security risk country.
Right. Because what happens is a lot of these... Christian enemies, enemies to Christianity, they will listen to these shows and figure out how you do it, and then they'll try to work against that.
Yes.
Very intelligent.
So I really can't share names or countries in a show like this,
right?
But I can give examples. And so this person, his father had been mid-management of a significant religious movement in his country of maybe more than 10 million people. Not of his father, but the whole movement has around 10 million. And his father was mid-management. And it's kind of a hereditary positions. And if you're really good, your part of the movement can expand or you can become more influential and so forth. So his father, since the time he was 12, was grooming him to take his place and even be groomed to take a more national leadership. He became a follower of Christ. His father is supposed to hand it over at his death. Mm-hmm. He has already handed it over to his son. Mm-hmm. His son is a follower of Christ, and he's now trying to bring all that part of the movement to be followers of Christ.
Mm. Wow.
And since he was 12, he has been brought into close relationship with the national leaders of that movement. Mm. He has been given free rein to preach all across as a popular preacher across a movement of around 10 million people.
This is a man that believes in the doctrines that we believe.
He is. He is a devout Seventh-day Adventist. Can't use that word in his country, but he's today sharing the Sabbath. An incredible thing. You ask how we work. I try to find people groups, pray that God will lead us to people groups that have lived to more light that they have had. And amazing, this people group of around 10 million, it's a religious movement. Uh-huh. They don't understand the Sabbath like we do, but they already reframe the whole movement for major travel and major business on Sabbath. Hmm. And so now he's going around preaching, why do we actually keep the Sabbath? And we were keeping it in our ignorance. Mm. Mm. There are very good reasons why. Mm. It's not just a tradition of our fathers sometime back.
Amazing.
So amazing. I have found Sabbath roots in every corner of the world. Mm. And our largest movements are happening where we have found these types of connections. The one in the Middle East where we have the largest one. Mm-hmm. It's based around a people group mm-hmm. that had a Sabbath tradition. And I have found Sabbath traditions just splattered across the planet.
Yeah, go ahead.
I read an article that Gospel Outreach put in their magazine and with the Hindu Brahmins and stuff.
Yes.
And it talked about when the Bible worker went to the temple to talk to the priest he asked him what are the Hindu people seeking or what's their biggest dream or something like that, I can't remember. And it was God coming as man, essentially.
Yes.
And I have never, after I read that, and I think you had told that, I tried to research on the internet about that, and I couldn't find anything. Now, I'm not saying it's not there, but I'm curious, like, what is that? Like, where does that come from in the Hindu
system? Well, it's quite interesting, and I don't want to expand too much on it on the air.
Okay.
Because 30, 40 years ago, missionaries jumped on the bandwagon of all these things, and then there was a massive retraction of ancient beliefs to try to negate what were commonalities mm-hmm. with the Bible. Mm-hmm. But to put it in a nutshell, Hinduism was originally, and we've done extensive study of, I haven't done it personally, but we arranged for that to happen. Mm. A team of people to extensively study the great controversy, the cosmic conflict among Hindus. Some highlights were they were originally monotheistic. Mm. They worshiped the one true God of heaven. Mm. They were not polytheists. Their ancient Rig Veda, the most respected holy book, is clearly a monotheistic book. And when it talks of the different gods, it's like in the Bible, one God, but we call him by different names, Jehovah, Jehovah Jireh, Elohim, and so forth. So you see different names, but it's all clearly talking about the one true God, mm-hmm. the creator of heaven and earth. Mm-hmm. And at one time, so according to Hindu understanding, their eschatology and their cosmic worldview, mm-hmm. religious is that at one time man was perfect. God created man to be perfect. He falls into sin. The reason this happens is there is a war in heaven, and 33 million angels, or they call them demigods, mm-hmm. this is the exact term they use, demigods, were expelled from heaven. Mm-hmm. These 33 million, of those that were expelled, 33 million come to India. Mm-hmm. And are Indian subcontinent. Come to the Indian subcontinent and establish themselves there. And so you see all these gods that they worship It is the incarnations or the of these 33 million evil angels that were expelled from heaven. Mm-hmm. And so out of fear, they worship them. But they know there is the one true God in heaven. And the Brahmins, the higher the caste up, the less paganism is mixed in into the mix. So a Brahmin, a well-educated Brahmin, knows there is one true God, but out of fear, we worship these people. Wow. I mean, these other
so
ones.
So right built in is this great controversy thing.
Right built in is the great controversy. And according to their most ancient prophecies, the creator of heaven and earth would one day come back to establish peace and order on earth.
It's unbelievable.
Much about him is predicted, even almost his name is predicted.
Really?
Yes. And so when they see this, so now, instead of coming with an outside gospel, you come calling people back. We need to live what we were called to be. We as Brahmins were called to worship the one true God. Wow. Why? What has happened? And so the history tells them that when they worshiped the one true God, they had a temple and they had an altar where they sacrificed to the true God of heaven and earth.
Wow.
With the passing of their time, they have the dates and the stories, they started calling the altar a god. Next thing, this isn't enough. We need an image. And an image goes. And more images. And more images to represent. Before long, images that represented the true creator God became gods themselves.
Wow.
And this was the beginning of paganism. Now when the Brahmin hears this story, my people, we were called to be like the Levites in the Bible so we can understand it. We as the priestly caste have taken the nation into darkness. They're cut to their hearts. Now we have to take them back to the true creator God. And by the way, he has already come. And the story of Jesus then becomes powerful. And then Jesus comes to push back the 33 million demons back to where they belong. We don't need them. We don't have to live in fear.
Amazing. You've seen people learning this and accepting this. This actually
I have personally gone to congregations on Sabbath packed
with
Hindu Brahmins on Sabbath, worshiping the one true creator God and reading the Bible.
Crazy.
Where do you even go from there?
You just say God is good, that's all. Yeah. I mean, praise the Lord, because so he's the one who protected.
Is there any more use for missionaries in Missionaries Day?
There is. There's a use for missionaries, but missionaries come like a spiritual archaeologist. There's two roles I see. He helps guide a process like that we just spoke about for a people group. And especially in people groups that are at odds with the large people group. Where the large people group can't really be an effective missionary due to years.
So sometimes cross-cultural missionary is harder within one country than somebody coming from...
Or even neighboring countries.
Or even neighboring due to things like this. So there is a place, but I see two things. He needs to model kingdom life in his own family. He invites someone who God has preordained and has been preparing that family for a very long time. And they now see how a godly life is lived out as we know it in Christ. I transfer that to him, and when it goes to that preordained person, it goes like viral, like fire.
Wow.
Because he's been prepared and his family's been prepared. Most of the people I work with, the family's been prepared 400 to 500 years in advance, is what I have seen.
Wow. So I know we're running...
Not everyone, but many, many are like this.
Yes, I know we're getting close to the end, but I want to make sure that we know what are your needs for this, because I know you have something else to share too.
Yes, needs right now.
How can people get involved?
People can get involved with prayer for closed countries. Lord, open up the country of Afghanistan. Please let your light shine in there. Rain down visions and dreams of Jesus. Rain down visions and dreams in Syria. Rain down, Lord, which country do you want me to pray for? And God will show you if you have an open heart. He will show you through circumstances and pressure.
They can get those little people group prayer cards.
They can.
From joshuaproject.net. There's like 100 top largest unreached people group. Start praying through
just
those.
Just start praying for those, and then God might tell you some other step. I met a young man in a university. A university asked me to go speak. And a young man said, I was praying some months ago, and I'd never heard of the country of Yemen. God just asked me to go to Yemen. Lord, I'd never heard. Is there even a country, Yemen? He starts Googling, and wow, there is a country of Yemen. Took about 18 months, and by God's divine providence, he found himself in the country of Yemen. God is good.
Yeah.
God, you know, we as Western people are afraid to let God speak into our lives.
Yeah.
We need to say, God, speak into my life. Mm. What do you want me to do about finishing your work here on earth? Mm-hmm. And sometimes it might be like him to go to Yemen, and sometimes it might be just go to cross town to a place that is unfamiliar to me. It might even to be reach out to my grandkids, you know?
Mm. Yeah.
Maybe my grandkid is my mission field.
But you sponsor Bible workers.
We do. We sponsor right now about 270, 280 Bible workers.
And those are house church coordinators.
These are coordinators. We pay for no house church leader. The minimum, 15 to 22. Some have hundreds.
So you're talking about
of house churches.
Of house churches.
So you don't pay anyone until they have at least 15.
No one gets anything. It doesn't even, they can't even bring it up until they have 15.
Wow. And how many do you still need to?
Right now, we have so many people with this call, come over to Macedonia, mm-hmm. help us. If we had 300 stipends, approximately $150, within 18 to 36 months, we'd have about 10,000 more house churches.
10,000 more house churches?
Yes, 10,000 more house churches. With about 100,000 people, with about 10 people each one. Because there's a lot of existing house churches that have been abandoned by different denominations that have been working in closed countries, and they abandoned, they are not part of a network. They have heard of our network, and they said, come train us. We like what you're doing.
Wow.
Those are just ones like that. That's not even reaching beyond that.
So if somebody wants to sponsor a house church coordinator,
yes.
How would they do that?
A sponsorship of about $150.
Where would they go? Who would they talk
to? And in Praxis International, we could maybe put
A website up. Praxis, NPRAXIS.com.
International. In Praxis International. I'll have to go and check. I'm sorry, but
you focus on the.
I focus on
the ministry, and not so much on letting people or fundraising.
I haven't. God has sent. I'm to the place where we really need to look at some more fundraising because there's so many opportunities. But
you said $150 per, and how many did you need?
300.
300.
So $45,000 a month.
Is this 40. You guys?
Yeah, but that it is, but it's one that really doesn't represent us.
Oh, okay. So that's not the right
one.
It was
one someone made about 6 years ago, and I don't have the password to open that one.
Oh, that's not helpful. Okay.
All right. Well, we'll get your contact information on the screen so people can get
in
touch.
Is this on you?
This is ours, and this is under construction, but this is.
Okay. That's inpraxisinternational.weebly.com.
Yes.
But it probably can go anyway. So NPRAXIS International, INTERNATIONAL.weebly.com.
Thank you, Donnie. That's awesome.
Thank you.
Okay.
So
for nearly $500,000, you could reach over 100,000 people.
Right tomorrow. They've been begging me for the last 2 years almost. I just haven't had time or finances to follow up.
That's $5 per person.
It's about $5 per person.
This is a great prayer call.
It is.
Call for prayer. So if you're watching now and you're hearing this, this is a big item on your prayer list. 100,000 Adventists in another country.
Believers.
Spread over numerous countries, big parts of them in two countries, but spread all across that area. There's groups saying, come, train us. We'd like what we have heard of the Adventist message. We'd like your training system. We have a very regular training system set up. And so it has grown from the first house church. The man who plants the first house church becomes the trainer. He trains 15 to 20. Those 15 to 20 train. And we're now in some countries six levels of training down.
Amazing. I know that we're out of time. You have you had a desire to share about the local work here in America.
And maybe we're out of time. I don't
know. I think that we are, correct?
We are, but...
Yeah, so you're going to have to come back, Marty. Sorry.
No problem.
Man, this is a fresh story, though. I know. It just happened yesterday and today.
I know, but if you're willing, I'm willing. I mean, it's our channel, right?
Yeah. Okay, Marty, have at it.
Okay, well, you know, I became convinced because as I started saying, I started talking about business as mission. And as I started to say, I had been preaching this, but then I found out that this is a core belief of the Mennonites. Mennonites have two big contributions, I believe, to the world. One is how to resolve conflict without fleeing and without fighting. Another belief that they have held and are now passing massively to the rest of the world, rest of the Christian world, followers of Christ, is that God has given work and business, not just to take funding from it to send a mission, but to use the social networks that you have within your work to expand the kingdom of God. And so I had been talking this because almost everyone that we give a stipend to are also involved in a sort of business or some work, a mom and pop shop from home or some trade or business investment or something on some larger, smaller scale. And we have seen that the more faithful they are to God, the bigger their business has grown. So some of our stipend workers now give back 5 to 6, 10 times their stipend. They have been blessed immensely financially over the last 5, 6 years that we've been working together, and they've learned to be faithful tithe payers. I went to a Mennonite training that talked about this, that we need to see holistic view of work. And that God and Satan are the real ones in this. They have a much like an Adventist understanding of the great controversy. Either it's blessed by God or it's blessed by Satan. And for the believer, God gives work to expand his work around the world through there, not just through the finances you make. So I was convicted. And I have rental houses in low-income area here in greater Chattanooga. I had seen that only as a means to make money. You get a larger return on low-income housing. And since I don't take a real salary from the ministry, I do. And then it hit me. I was not practicing what I was preaching. I needed to see that is also a part of my ministry. In the area now, all these homes aren't mine, but there's a community of 73 houses. And I own maybe one-fifth of those houses. One-fifth, one-quarter, something like this. And less than 3 years ago, there were two brothels in the community of 73 houses. There were two crack houses. There was probably one or two meth houses. A lot of the women, even married women, involved with prostitution. 14-year-olds were selling meth at school, making more 3 to 6 times more money than their teachers. But living in horrible conditions. That's right in our backyard. Welcome to low-income America.
Wow.
17% of America, I've done a lot of research, live in conditions that middle-class America have absolutely no idea about.
Really?
And I was convicted. That's also my mission field, not just out there. I needed to become involved in the lives of my tenants. It wasn't something that really called my attention, but I became convicted. There needed to be changes. Now, many changes happen not due to me. Landlords decided to close down. The other landlord who held the rest of the houses decided there was going to be no more crack houses, no more houses of prostitution. All this was closed down and left. Before, 14-year-olds, remember, they're selling meth in school, making big money off of this. Now there's those are all gone. Two 14-year-olds in that place have brought God's kingdom into that park among the kids.
Really? And you got involved with them? Friends with them?
I'm friends with all of them. We pray together. How do we resolve conflict? It's another world. Every home in there, they know each other. Everyone's involved with everybody's lives. And husbands might not show up for a week, and the wives have no idea where they are. That's happened several times. The wife, can you come pray for me? And God has done miracles. The husband shows up that evening, and they can't believe it.
Wow.
Doesn't mean everything's resolved and happy in the home, but we see this mending of social relationships. And I've really invested a lot of time into two young boys, especially one. And those two boys, it's amazing. A denomination not of ours, but they come in with a van, take kids to a very boring prayer meeting every Wednesday. But those two boys get every one of those kids in that low-income neighborhood dressed as best they can, get them ready, and take them to prayer meeting. And it's like, wow, God is doing amazing things. And I've started investing more and more time into this young man. And today I was really bummed. I don't work on Sabbath, obviously, but if you have an emergency, a water line break or something like this, I need to go out there and take care of something that's going to create a disaster and a huge inconvenience. It's not their fault. I'm a Sabbath keeper. So I had an emergency, I had to go out, and I was really bummed because I don't like to do that. And I had wanted to go to church. I went to Sabbath school then, went, and then I realized God was wanting me to take to church to one of these two young men. And so I had to go buy a part to do the repair. And so I said, hey, why don't you come with me? And so the young man asked permission from his mom. The mom was very happy I would take him. And so we went down to buy, and so we just started talking. And it's become increasingly harder. I've done a lot of the statistics for someone from low-income America to ever even think of college or even think of going beyond their circumstances. So this morning, church with him was, son, you need to think of getting a good education. He already is a straight-A student. A B for him, he cries over. And I says, you know, you can't just dream of being a construction worker. You have to dream of being a contractor. God has made you for so much more. And so many times we don't see the mission field in our backyard. And I'm just a small little businessman with a few houses. But, you know, I just have this passion that God would. You know, there's a lot of wealthy businessmen that are Adventists. There's a lot of wealth right here in Chattanooga. And my challenge would be, even if you never give a penny to mission, take the mission to your employees. You have no idea how some of them live. You know, nothing, I don't want to get involved in politics, but what has happened in the last few years under the present administration and saying to help people with health care has severely hurt the poor America. Because now what do all the places from Walmart to Publix do? 29 hours. And they make about $290 a week. How can an American family of four or five today live on $290 a week when the head of household is making this type of money? You can't survive for eight. Average low-income family I have as tenants make between $8, and they're extremely happy if they're paid $13 an hour. And that's just very hard to survive on that, and their children have no real dream of getting any more than what their parents lived. So that has become a little bit of my passion of standing up for them. I see the, I mean, the way the police treat me in the neighborhood I work with and the way the police treat them in the neighborhood they work with. They're whites, like I am, but live in a totally different world. It's a totally different world how the law treats both of us. Mm. And I mean, it's really broken my heart to see what happens in my backyard and had no idea as I became involved in the life of my tenants. And I've just been really touched to see how God is taking his kingdom into a place I never dreamed of doing.
Wow. Wow. So, so you see, yeah, this is, you see power in the gospel.
I see power in the gospel. Two young men is changing the lives of all the children in that neighborhood. And I'd never seen a thing like this. I mean, they go run. They know it's at Wednesday, 6:30, the church bus comes through. At 6, they stop anything they're doing and they bring all the kids. A few years ago, that would have been hustling all the little kids to sell meth, which is a cheap drug in the greater Chattanooga area.
Wow.
And a lot of low-income people are hooked to meth and hooked to other drugs. And this is why then they have to live a life of crime.
So God needs you to invest in other neighborhoods.
I don't know. God is calling other people. I don't have a lot more time to do than what I'm doing due to the mission work I'm involved with. But it has brought me also, I must say, to be honest, a lot of compassion. I used to not feel compassion. And for people like that, I thought, oh, they're just a bunch of lazy. And I just saw it as a source of income for me. My tenants, and now God's convicted me I need to bring his kingdom into the life of my tenants. And I didn't think about it until this morning. In this community of 73 houses, my houses are dotted kind of strategically. That's just the way I ended up acquiring them. And so I know almost all the families in those, in that neighborhood.
Just by chance.
I don't want to say chance, I would say by God's providence. I used to see it by chance. It never even hit me until this morning, because this morning I went over really bummed, because I like church, I wanted to sit down and relax, and I get a phone call last night saying there's a thing, could you wait for the morning? And they agreed to wait for the morning. And then I realized I was called to take church to that young man and really challenge him. I said, you know, God has made you son for so much more. So you need to think big for God.
So you had that ride with him in the car.
Yeah, and we had that ride. And that ride for him was my church time, basically. And I realized God had allowed that water leak to happen so I could take church to this young man. Because I'm sure after this morning, he'll never be the same again. He will now think big. He doesn't have to live in fear. And I feel a lot of low-income people, as I've got to know them better, a lot that holds them down is fear.
Wow. And that's what holds us away from reaching them, going out and touching them, is our fear. Fear of moving outside.
Whether it's
there,
it's just moving outside of our comfort zone. It's, I think we all are bound by fears, whether it's mission across the world or mission across my street, or a shame to me, I don't know any of my neighbors. They don't know me. And we'd probably look pretty weird at each other. Why have you come over to my house?
Yeah, I keep thinking of maybe if I could bake a loaf of bread, take it over there. We went caroling at Christmas.
Our time is 15 minutes over now.
I'm sorry.
And no, it's okay. I mean,
and
it was
people
a good story.
Loved it. And they says, we haven't heard carolers in years, 10, 15 years. And they just want, some people cried.
Yeah.
Just it's simple just act
for
of caroling.
Saying hello.
So I was thinking about caroling and February, August, I don't know, something.
Well, I hate to say it, but we need to wrap up.
Yes.
And Marty, I just really want to thank you for sharing with us both the work that's going on over there, but also the work that is close by. And many times we see it as we see missions like as a definition overseas. But there is a lot of work to do here, but that doesn't mean God only wants us to work here.
Yes, absolutely.
He's opened your heart to the people around the world. It's kind of neat that you get to see the whole, I mean, a broader picture. But God doesn't just want that for Marty. He wants that for each of us, yeah. That full involvement and understanding and compassion and looking at all of his children the same way. Mm-hmm. So I want to invite you as our viewers to pray for him, Praxis, pray for Marty and his wife Gabby and the work that they're doing, and look and pray, ask the Lord, what should I be doing? What should I be praying for? What people group should I be praying for? What country? What, you know, what should I be praying for? Lord, is there something you want me to do right here in my local area, in my job, in my business, if I have a business, whatever? Lord, what is your will for my life? Because he will show you, and it will bring you so many blessings, so much joy. You'll be exposed to where maybe you need to expand your horizons, like Marty was sharing just now. Maybe he will take you to a place that's beautiful and exotic. You don't know until you ask him. But I can guarantee that you will find joy in serving. You will find joy in loving our neighbors as ourselves. May God bless you until we see you again on Mission TV Live.